Dear viewers, after the stupendous response for our previous sessions, I am delighted to bring you the fifth deliberation of the series. Your patronage is our driving force to bring much needed attention on the herb and gynec practices. Our objective is to reach all those herb-gyn enthusiasts who form a key in healthcare of women in India. And our due attention is also on justified integration of the sciences for the same. Today's deliberation is on abnormal uterine bleeding. Blood loss during menstruation is a physiological response between the interplay of the hormones and the uterine response. At times, this becomes worrisome, especially when it is beyond the normal limits, often landing up the woman at emergency room. So it becomes essential to be all ears when the patient is presenting complaint with represent of abnormal uterine bleeding. Studies from the PubMed have also suggested the prevalence of abnormal uterine bleeding is somewhere around 35% in gynecological care, and the incidence is much higher during the menarche and menopause. Abnormal uterine bleeding can often be noted in primary care during regular routine screening for women for varied presentations, and an appropriate referral can be life-saving. We are excited to present you two speakers from either sciences who will share their views and clinical experiences with abnormal uterine bleeding. Let me now take you to Dr. Mamata KV, Professor and HOD, Department of Postgraduate Studies of Prasuti Tantra and Sri Roga, also the Medical Superintendent of SDM Ayurveda Medical College, Udupi. And later to Dr. Pradeepa R, who is a consultant obstetrician and gynecologist at St. Philomena's Hospital and also Malathi Manipal Hospital, Bengaluru. So let's now hear from Dr. Mamata KV upon the Ayurvedic concepts of abnormal uterine bleeding.
I'm Dr. Mamata, working as professor and HOD in the Department of Prasuti Tantra and Sri Roga, and I'm also medical superintendent at SDM Hospital of Ayurveda, Udupi. Today, my topic for discussion would be Asradhara, a description of abnormal uterine bleeding in the classics of Ayurveda. There is a common question everybody asks: is there any reference of abnormal vaginal bleeding in Ayurveda? My answer would be yes, because we have an elaborate description of abnormal uterine bleeding or abnormal vaginal bleeding in the classics of Ayurveda. Let us look into the references where all it is formed, how it is managed, and how collectively, what all conditions we can manage through Ayurveda. So to start with, what is the definition of this Asradhara word, which is defined or which is explained as excessive bleeding, or the word which is used to explain excessive bleeding in Ayurveda? That is Rajaha Pradhiryate Yasmat Pradaraha Tena Sasmrata, or Asrat Diryate Chavate Yasmin Iti Asratdaram. Either the word Pradara or the word Asratdara denotes excessive vaginal bleeding in the classics of Ayurveda. In both these conditions, we find the reference of excessive vaginal bleeding in Ayurvedic classics or literatures. Now, enlisting what are the conditions where we find this excessive bleeding as a symptom in gynecological conditions. As we discussed, Asradhara or Pradara is explained as an independent disease where excessive, abnormal, untimely vaginal bleedings are described in classics of Ayurveda. Other than that, we also find the reference of Rakta Yoni, where he says Rakta Yoni Akhya Asrat Atishrute, there is excessive bleeding in Rakta Yoni also. It is a Yoni Vyapat. Then in case of Asraja or Apraja Yoni Vyapat also, we find this excessive bleeding. In this condition, the references suggest us that there would be some changes in the endometrium, by which even if the pregnancy or there is a conception, the conceptus will not be supported by the endometrium, and the endometrium will be totally shed off, because along with the fetus, and we can say this as a preclinical abortion like conditions. Then in case of Pittavrata Apana Dushti or Pittavrata Apana like conditions, we have excessive vaginal bleeding, along with which there will be Haridra Varnata of Varcha, will be yellowish discoloration of skin, body, etc. And there will be excessive burning sensation or heat sensation in the vaginal as well as in the anal area, the rectal or anal area. Then in case of Lohita Kshara Yoni Vyapata, also we find excessive bleeding as a symptom. Then we have a reference of unique condition called as Rakta Pitta, where through all the orifices of body, there will be excessive bleeding or there will be uncontrolled bleeding. Out of that, a condition Adhoga Rakta Pitta denotes, or Adhoga Rakta Pitta is explained as there would be bleeding from all the downward passages or orifices of the body, such as from the urethral meatus, from the vagina, and from the rectal orifice. Then in case of Arthavadushti also, a condition explained as Punapagandhi Arthavadushti, where a foul-smelling bleeding is found along with excessive or increase in its quantity. So these are the conditions, independent diseases wherein excessive bleeding with some other associated complaints is the presenting feature in case of Ayurvedic reference. Then, apart from these conditions, in some of the gynecological situations, we find excessive bleeding as a complication of main disease. It may not be the only presenting feature, but main disease, if it is not treated for prolonged period, if the pathogenesis is allowed to stand for prolonged duration, the condition may also convert into abnormal uterine bleeding like condition, or it may, as a complication of this main disease, there can be abnormal uterine bleeding. So out of that, Rakta Dushti is one condition where Rakta and Pitta, they are very much associated with each other. They are said to be in Ashraya, Ashrayi, Bhava also. In Rakta Dushti conditions, we find Pradara as a complication. In case of Vataja, Pittaja and Kafaja Yoni Vyapar, Chakrapani Tika very clearly says that if these conditions are not treated, all these yoni vyapats are not treated, ultimately they will result in Ashtavdara like conditions. Then in case of all 20 yoni vyapats, as a complication of all the 20 yoni vyapats, not only these 3 or 4, all yoni vyapats, if they are long standing conditions, if they become chronic, then the chronicity of the disease will be linked with the excessive bleeding. As a complication, excessive bleeding may also be present in those patients. So in general, we can say that all the diseases of gynecology in Ayurveda are ending up, if not treated properly, they may be ending with the excessive bleeding. So that denotes that Ayurvedic classics or the Acharyas of Ayurveda had a very elaborate knowledge about this particular condition. Then coming to what are the etiological factors of this Ashtavdara or excessive or abnormal vagina bleeding? As I discussed earlier, Ashtavdara and Rakta Dushti almost go hand in hand. Pitta is said to be the main culprit in cases of abnormal uterine bleeding. Rakta and Pitta, they are associated with each other. So the nidanas or the etiological factors of Ashtavdara disease and the causes of Rakta Dushti are almost found to be overlapping in each other. So if we further classify these nidanas or etiological factors, we can find Aharaja Nidanas, Viharaja Nidanas, or the Manasika Bhavas, which are leading to this particular disease. So out of the Aharaja Bhavas, Mainly or importantly, we can see the patients or the people or the ladies who are indulging in excessive intake of hot, spicy, pungent, kshara, ushna, tikshna, we call it as, or salty diet. So always consuming this kind of diet in their as their main food habit will land up with asratara like diseases. Or it's not only hot, spicy, pungent. If excessively they are in a habit of consuming kheer or payasa, or if every day they have a habit of consuming curds, particularly after consumption of these curds, they go for a day sleeping. Or if they are taking a unique concept again of Ayurveda, that is Viruddhana, the antagonistic food combinations, they are consuming such kind of combination of food, then if the food, the whatever the patient has consumed, if not properly digested, then also it will become a cause for excessive abnormal uterine bleeding. Under the Viharaja Nidanas, or the lifestyle, or the way of life, it is said that excessive coital activity, excessive physical activity, particularly in continuous standing, continuous sitting posture, excessive weight lifting, day sleeping, or night out, abortion, undergoing abortion, extreme emaciation, exposure to sunlight, controlling of urges, all these are said to be the causes of asratara or nidanas of asratara. Then manasika bhavas, if we see, it may be all the factors which are influencing the hypothalamus pituitary ovarian axis, like excessive sadness, excessive anger, agony, or stressful life, or even the local injury to the uterine apparatus, the pelvic girdle. If there is any trauma or injury to the local area, that can also give rise to the disease asratara. So on analyzing these nidanas, it may be in a way it is bringing about some enzymatic changes in the quality as well as quantity of blood, one question mark. And second thing is excessive coitus, post-abortion, excessive bleeding, all these we routinely see in the practice. Maybe they are in a way bringing about some congestion in the pelvic vascular tree, thereby giving rise to this excessive bleeding. And in case of manasika bhavas, as discussed, hypothalamus pituitary ovarian axis is disturbed by these kind of psychological impressions and influences, thereby giving rise to anovulation, thus precipitating an ovulatory dysfunctional uterine bleeding or metropathia hemorrhagica like conditions, etc. Then coming to how all these etiological factors are landing into the pathogenesis of excessive or abnormal uterine bleeding. We find a very beautiful description of this samprapti or pathogenesis of disease asratara. As discussed earlier, all the dosha, all the nidanas, whatever set under the heading of etiology, are capable of vitiating the doshas. So all together or independently, three doshas are involved in this particular disease, predominantly pitta and rakta. So when they are impaired, obviously its impact is on digestive fire as a first line. When the digestive fire is impaired, the formation of rasa dhatu is improper. Rasa, when it is improperly formed, its direct effect is seen in artava, its uparartha. So artava is nothing but the menstrual fluid, or it is nothing but the ovum, what we say, or the entire the hormonal panel, which is bringing about the menstrual function. So there will be some qualitative or quantitative abnormality in the formation of this artava. Then how it is bringing about the pathogenesis is, it's a very beautiful explanation where he says that raktam pramanataha utkramya garbhashaya gataha siraha. So rakta not only getting impaired qualitatively, it even increases quantitatively, and rajovahaha samashritya raktamadaya tadrajaha. So it is accumulated in the siras of garbhashaya, that is the blood vessels of garbhashaya are filled with this abnormal artava. This abnormal accumulation of abnormal artava in the blood vessels of garbhashaya further results in abnormal or prolonged or excessive vaginal bleeding. This is a beautiful samprapti described in the classics, wherein it says that all the excessive or abnormal uterine bleeding are associated with some kind of congestion in the pelvic vessels. If we analyze the causes of excessive vaginal abnormal or excessive or abnormal vaginal bleeding, all the reasons listed in PAMCOIN under the heading of PAMCOIN, we find invariably there is association of congestion in the pelvic blood vessels. You take leiomyoma, you take adenomyosis, you take polyp, you take malignancy, you take coagulopathy, whatever it is, the abnormality is found in the pelvic vascularity, then there will be excessive bleeding. So the samprapti of this abnormal uterine bleeding is bringing about some congestion due to various etiological factors. It may be a granthi also, or it may be a simple endometrial derangement or hyperplasia also. So the samanya lakshana or the common feature we find in the sastrakriya is untimely excessive bleeding. This untimely excessive bleeding even includes the postmenopausal bleeding also. It is not only during the menstruating period, it is even in the postmenstrual, postmenopausal period. If there is excessive bleeding, that can also be included in this. Then it is untimely in the sense polymenorrhagia, metrorrhagia, whatever kind of excessive bleeding, all are included under the samanya lakshana of this. And as an associated feature for this asradhara, we find bleeding with pain or body ache. It is not the simple bleeding, whatever is seen during normal period of menstruation. The sastradhara bleeding or abnormal uterine bleeding is may be associated with body ache or the pain with menstruation. Here, if I look back and analyze Shuddhartha Lakshana, which is a unique concept described in Ayurveda, wherein he says that these are the qualities, like there some qualities are enumerated, Shashastra Pratimam Yattu, various ranges of red color are explained as normal tinge of menstrual blood. One, various smell or odor of menstrual blood, various in the sense, a typical kind of odor is said to be the normal lakshana of menstrual blood. The menstrual blood should not be associated with excessive clotting or excessive mucoid discharges. The menstrual blood should not have staining of the clots. It should not leave a stain on the clot when it is washed away properly. Then it should not be associated with very severe other features like maybe backache or burning sensation or feverishness, etc., etc. So this Shuddhartha Lakshana, the abnormal uterine bleeding with the blood in this abnormal uterine bleeding will not have the Shuddhartha Lakshanas that we have to remember. And neither it is associated with normal functioning of this menstruation. So normal, what are the functions of this menstruation will not be served by this abnormal condition. Then, Astradhara, though, is a vyadhi as an independent one disease. Depending on the predominance of doshas in this particular condition, several features may vary in this. For example, if vata predominant Astradhara is there, the quantity of bleeding may not be very excessive. The blood discharged here may have a darker red tinge or a blackish tinge, or sometimes patient may even say that it's a brownish tinge or maroonish tinge of blood can be seen. The smell of this menstrual blood will be of metallic in nature. Then the consistency of menstrual blood would be very watery. The clot are very minimal or sparse clots or small clots may be seen in this, and associated with this bleeding there will be very severe pain. The pain may not be located only in the lower abdomen, rather in the entire pelvic girdle, the pain may be radiating or is present. the flow, when it flows down, the menstrual blood, when it flows down, patient may experience this blood as cold kind of blood, or nature of this blood will be cold. In case of Pitta predominant abnormal bleeding, we find a profuse continuous flow of bleeding with a bright or dark red in color, maybe yellowish tinges associated with this. The odor of the menstrual blood would be fishy in nature, fishy odor may be there. The glistening appearance of the menstrual blood may also be seen sometimes. Usually this is also not clotted one, and burning kind of pains. There may be burning in the eyes, there may be burning in the palms and soles of the body. Whole body may be found as burning, associated with burning sensation. And sometimes the inflammatory features in the local area may also be found, color, rubor, dollar kind of inflammatory features may be observed in this Pitta predominant Astragdara. Then in Kaphaja Astragdara, there may be slow flow. It's not very excessive flow, but continuous flow will be there. The blood is having a pale tinge of red. A fatty odor may be seen. The very characteristic feature of this Kaphaja Astragdara is the blood is mixed with mucoid discharges, or you can say a slimy kind of discharges will be seen in Kaphaja Astragdara. Most often, patient explains you that there will be big clots passed in case of Kaphaja Astragdara. A kind of dull ache or pain will be seen in the lower abdomen with Kaphaja Astragdara, and a lethargy, heaviness, dyspnea, and flow of blood is experienced as very cold stream of blood is in Kaphaja Astragdara, seen in Kaphaja Astragdara. In Sannipataja Astragdara, all mixed features will be seen. The smell may vary sometimes with the dosha predominance also, or sometimes foul smelling discharges can also be seen. The color of the menstrual blood may be varying, sometimes very dark, sometimes brownish red or blackish red kind of discharges. So in Sannipataja, mixed features of menstruation may be seen. Then coming to Chikitsa, usually all kinds of Astragdara can be very effectively treated through Ayurvedic treatment. Many hysterectomies, untimely hysterectomies at the age of 34, 36 and all can be very definitely avoided if timely Ayurvedic interventions are being done in case of Astragdara disease. So in Astragdara condition, we can classify the Chikitsa as one as Nidana Parivarjana. If the patient discontinues whatever is the positive factor for the occurrence of the disease, that is first line of its management. And whatever treatment we give, if the patient do not eliminate the etiological factors, the disease is not going to cure. It will recur with the, it will cure with the treatment, and but next after 3 or 4 months or 6 months, it can again recur if the patient continues to have the etiological factors. Then Samshodhana Chikitsa, that is purification, biopurification of the body in the form of Vamana, Virechana, Basti or Nasya is very effective mode of treatment. Vamana is specially useful in cases of excessive bleeding of Kaphaja variety, in cases of space occupying lesion like fibroid associated condition, hyperplasia of endometrium whenever it is seen, or whenever there is adenomyosis is seen. So in all these conditions, Vamana would be the first line of management. A simple dysfunctional uterine bleeding is best treated with Virechana line of management. Excessive bleeding, even in case of archaica or emergency condition, not responding to any other treatment, may be very effectively managed with Matra Basti or Pichha Basti kind of things, that is Basti, effectiveness of Basti. In case of anovular dysfunctional uterine bleeding or irregular cycles, in all these hypothalamopituitary ovarian axis disturbances there, in these conditions, even Nasya is the very effective line of management in Samshodhana Chikitsa. After a course of Samshodhana, once the toxins of the body are removed, eliminated, once the pathogenesis is reverting, started reverting back, the Shaman Aushadhis are useful. In Shaman Aushadis, we can think in two directions. One is Vyadi Pratyanika Chikitsa, another is Dosha Pratyanika Chikitsa. In Vyadi Pratyanika Chikitsa, grossly all the hemostatic drugs to have cessation of that excessive bleeding in acute phases of bleeding, we can think of Vyadi Pratyanika Chikitsa, direct stoppage of the bleeding, excessive flow if it is there, stopping that with the septic medicines. Then in Dosha Pratyanika Chikitsa, depending on the lakshanas, we have to assess the patient. Depending on the nidanas, we have to assess the patient what is the variety of vatsatara, whether it is vatacha, pittacha or kaphacha. If vata predominant, the line of management would be astragdara chikitsa with vatahara, astragdara chikitsa with pittahara management, and astragdara chikitsa with kaphadoshahara line of management. So this would be the shamana chikitsa. And if the symptoms are controlled, or symptoms are under control, then if the further rejuvenation of the patient, or you can say the rakta dhatu is lost excessively in this particular disease, to give rasayana, or you can say rakta kshaya, here we have to give the rejuvenation or rasayana chikitsas depending on the prakriti of the patient, depending on the availability of the drug, depending on the affording of the patient, capacity of the patient, we can go for rasayana chikitsas. Out of the shamana chikitsas, usually practiced ones in kashaya dravyas are musali kadiradi kashaya, vasa guruchyadi kashaya, panchavalkala kashaya, the best among all. Then Chandanadi, Sukumara, Gandharvahastadi, Gogula Pittaka Kashayas. In Rasaushadis, we often use Pradarari, Pradaradipurasa, Bola Badarasa, Bola Parpati, Chandrakala Rasa, Pradarantaka Loha, Pradarantaka Rasa. Out of the Grata preparations, Vasa Grata, Shatavari Grata, Draksha Grata, Mahatiktaka, Tiktaka Gratas, Kalyana Grata, Sukumara Grata, Kutajakashma Dhyadi Grata. Several studies have been conducted on this Kutajakashma Dhyadi Grata in our center. Then out of Asava Arrestas, Pitranga, Draksha, Ashoka, Rodra, Chandana, Anjista, these are the drugs. Then Churnas, Pushyanaka Churna, Nagakeshava Churna, Lodra Churna, Amalaki, Chandana and Estimada Churna, in combination these are given. Then in Kshirapaka, Balamukha Kshirapaka, Shatavari Kshirapaka, Ashokatva Kshirapaka are the some drugs which have been tried in our center. Kushmanda Rasayana, Draksha Valeha, Narasimha Rasayana are the Rasayana Chikitsas which are having Stambaka activity, hemostatic, as well as they are the disease having influence or impact in curing the disease. For simple and single drug therapies, we can say Saraka Ashoka, Ashoka, Adathoda Vasika, Vasa, the best drug, Simplicus Resimos or Resimosa or Lodha, Mimosa, that is Mimosa Pudica, catch me not, then Sinalon Dactylon, that is Durva, Vitivedia Zizinoides, Ushira, Santalum Album, Chandana, and all Pikus group of drugs are having best hemostatic activity, which can be very, very used during the acute episode of bleeding. So this is the brief description of Astragdara in Ayurveda. It's a scope in the treatment, how, in what all conditions we can go for treatment of Astragdara. So varying from simple dysfunctional uterine bleeding till fibroid adenomyosis, we can hyperplasia of endometrium, of course, where there is no risk of turning into malignancy. In all these conditions, except malignant conditions, we can definitely give a definite treatment for Astragdara through Ayurveda. We can manage Astragdara through Ayurveda. Thank you.
It's time now to hear from Dr. Pradeepa R. about the modern concepts on abnormal uterine bleeding.
This is Dr. Pradeepa. I am practicing obstetrics and gynecology at Malathi Manipal Hospital and St. Philomena's Hospital, Bangalore. Today we will be discussing a very important topic, abnormal uterine bleeding. So abnormal uterine bleeding. So what is abnormal uterine bleeding? It is any change in the frequency of menstruation, the duration of flow, and in the amount of flow. So what is normal menstrual bleeding? In a woman having regular cycles, the duration of flow will be 2 to 7 days, and the amount of blood loss will be less than 80 ml. The cycle length varies in between 21 to 35 days. A normal menstrual cycle is usually 28 days plus or minus 7 days. Any deviation from these things will cause an abnormal uterine bleeding. So why we need to know about abnormal uterine bleeding? Because it impacts on the quality of life, and there can be consequences like infertility, and long term they can have endometrial cancer. Due to excessive bleeding, they can have anemia, and there can be financial burden. These are all the old terminologies used for abnormal uterine bleeding. So menorrhagia. Menorrhagia means excessive blood flow, both in amount and duration. Metrorrhagia, where infrequent menses along with menorrhagia. Then hypomenorrhea. Hypo means reduced blood loss. So scanty blood flow is called hypomenorrhea. Oligomenorrhea, that means the cycle length lasts more than 35 days. Very infrequent cycles. Poly means frequent. Frequent menorrhagia. Every less than 21 days, if the woman is having frequent periods, then it is called polymenorrhea. Amenorrhea, where there is no period. Dysmenorrhea, where there is painful menstruation. So the newer terminology is heavy menstrual bleeding, which again is classified into acute and chronic. And second one is intermenstrual bleeding. Acute bleeding, whenever a woman comes with acute excessive bleeding in the first episode, we call them, they come into this category of acute heavy menstrual bleeding. Wherever if the bleeding is present for more than 6 months, they come into the category of chronic heavy menstrual bleeding. Intermenstrual bleeding, any point of time during menses or in between cycles, if they develop bleeding, it is called intermenstrual bleeding. So what is heavy menstrual bleeding? Excessive menstrual blood loss, which interferes with women's physical, emotional, and quality of life. Whatever it is, if it's disturbing, then it is called heavy menstrual bleeding. This is the latest terminology which we use nowadays.
So FIGO classification system for causes of abnormal uterine bleeding in the reproductive years. It is classified into POM COAM. POM stands for P for polyp, A adenomyosis, L leiomyoma, and M for malignancy and hyperplasia. These are all the structural abnormality where we can find out the cause through either ultrasound or hysteroscopy. The other thing is COAM. It is no, there won't be any structural abnormality. There will be functional disturbances. C for coagulopathy, O ovulatory dysfunction, E endometrial causes, I iatrogenic, N for not yet classified. So how can we go about this abnormal uterine bleeding? Whenever a woman comes with complaints of excessive bleeding, PV, first thing is the history. A thorough history is very important so that we can come to a conclusion. So first thing is duration. How long she is having the excessive bleeding, and what is the amount of bleeding? How many pads in a day she is changing? Whether she is passing any clots? Presence of clots indicates that she is having menorrhagia. And what is the cycle length in between? How many days she is free from bleeding, and the regularity of the cycle? Whether there is any intermenstrual bleeding present or not? The second question we need to ask is about pain, whether there is associated pain or not, because pain is very important and it is present in case of fibroid adenomyosis. So whenever there is a pain, we need to differentiate whether it is spasmodic or congestive, and whether the pain is related to any chronic pelvic pain or whether it is related with sexual intercourse. Then whether she is on any medications, whether it is due to any drug induced like anticoagulants, tamoxifen, this causes endometrial hyperplasia that can cause excessive bleeding. and any hormonal contraceptives. Suppose if she's not taking any hormonal contraceptives regularly, then she will have this kind of irregular cycles and irregular bleeding. Even if the woman has taken any eye pill, levonorgestrel as an emergency contraception, she may have irregularity in her cycles. And drugs like antidepressants and antipsychotics and steroids. So after history, then examination. Coming to examination, the important thing which we need to note is pallor. Pallor indicates the severity of the bleeding, whether she is very pale or moderate or mild pallor. And the weight is also very important because in a woman having PCOS and thyroid, her BMI, her weight will be very, height will be more, her BMI will be overweight or obese range. So they have a lot of hormonal imbalance due to hyperestrogenism. They can have this menorrhagia and irregular cycles. So pallor and weight comes to general examination is very important. Then abdominal examination, whether any mass is palpable per abdomen, either from uterine mass or ovarian mass. And then speculum examination to rule out whether there is any polyp or any cervical lesions causing abnormal uterine bleeding. Usually the cervical lesions, they cause postcoital bleeding and intermenstrual bleeding, and if there is any cervical cancer. So cervical perspeculum examination is very, very important for the cervical lesions. Then vaginal examination to know the size of the uterus, the contour, consistency, tenderness, and the fornicial tenderness. All these things will be made out by pervaginal examination, which is called bimanual pelvic examination. After the examination, we need to confirm the diagnosis either by imaging or specialized test. So first, coming to the blood test, we will ask for complete blood count because whether we need to know about her hemoglobin status, because her the women should be stable for any further procedure. First, stabilization is very, very important because many women will come with excessive bleeding. They will ignore and they'll come with severe anemia, which may require blood transfusion. So hemoglobin is the first thing. Second thing, in a reproductive age group, urine pregnancy test is the first thing which we need to rule out any pregnancy, the like cause for menorrhagia, like incomplete abortion or any ectopic pregnancy. Also, they'll have bleeding and pain, and any molar pregnancy, or sometimes they will take pills without any scan or anything. So urine pregnancy test is very, very important. In a woman, first thing we need to rule out is pregnancy. Then from puberty, if they have excessive bleeding, the thing which we need to rule out is coagulopathies by means of bleeding time, platelet count, prothrombin time, and partial thromboplastin time. The other thing which we have to rule out is thyroid test, because hypothyroid, if it is not corrected or undercorrected, they can have excessive bleeding or menorrhagia. After blood test, the next thing will be the ultrasound. So if the woman is sexually active, then transvaginal ultrasound will give us exact information about the uterus, endometrial thickness, and adnexal masses if present. And if there are any uterine abnormalities like fibroid, adenomyosis, polyp can be well made out. And if required, the 3D ultrasound also can be used to locate exactly where is the location of the fibroid. Even polyp can be diagnosed easily by 3D ultrasound. Sonoinfusion salpingography. This is done basically by ultrasound by infusion of saline through cervix. So the cavity will be distended with saline and scanning will be done. So if there is any intracavitary lesion, it will be easily picked out by this method. And required cases, optional MRI and hysteroscopy will be used to diagnose other conditions like mapping of fibroid, where she wants to conserve uterus in a case of infertility. We will ask this MRI. Otherwise, it is not routinely used to diagnose AUB. So suppose, next thing, we have done scan and the woman is having endometrial thickness. So what we can do? The first thing we need to consider is her age. If the woman is more than 40 years or nearing menopause, perimenopause, all these things, we need to rule out endometrial cancer or hyperplasia because that is the age group where it is most common and it is always treatable. It takes long time to spread. The symptoms will manifest first. So we need to do endometrial biopsy. The first thing which we can do is endometrial Pipelli biopsy. It is an OPD procedure where anesthesia is not required. we can just use a small cannula of about 3 millimeter, and then the endometrial tissue can be sent for histopathology. Suppose if the woman is less than 40 years, but she is having bleeding with the risk of endometrial cancers or obesity, diabetes, PCOD, hypertension, or any family history of malignancy, or if the woman is on tamoxifen, all these are high risk factors. So even if they are 40 years with thickened endometrium and heavy menstrual bleeding, we need to, if we want to rule out endometrial cancer, first thing is we can do endometrial aspiration using Pippalis biopsy. It is an OPD procedure. Suppose if the woman is very obese and os is very much closed and she can't bear even little pain, then the next option will be dilatation and curettage. Suppose the sample is inadequate with this procedure, then we can ask for dilatation and curettage. There is nothing called therapeutic dilatation and curettage. Mainly it is used as a diagnostic procedure where we require endometrial tissue for histopathological examination. Suppose in scan, if they are showing any polyp, then directly hysteroscopy can be done, and then we can visualize the cavity and we can remove the polyp same sitting, and if required, endometrial tissue also can be taken for biopsy, because the most common site for endometrial cancer is the base of the polyp. So coming to the treatment part, the first line of management will be always an NSAIDs and antifibrinolytics. We get as a combination of tranexamic acid and mefenamic acid. This is the first line treatment, and a long lasting and permanent, the second line will be LNG IUS. The other things are GnRH analogs, oral contraceptive pills, and cyclic progesterones. These are all the pharmacological methods, and surgical methods will be endometrial ablation. Last thing will be hysterectomy. When the medical management fails, the surgical management last resort will be hysterectomy. And uterine fibroid embolization, it is still under trial. So why we are using NSAIDs? Because the prostaglandins will be elevated in heavy menstrual bleeding. So we use this NSAIDs, which inhibit COX and decreases the prostaglandins and decreases the blood loss by about 20 to 50%. This also improves dysmenorrhea in 70% of the women. It can be given for 5 days. 3 times a day can be given. Most commonly used drug is mefenamic acid. Tranexamic acid, it is an antifibrinolytic. The mechanism of action is it inhibits plasminogen. So 1 gram every 6 hours decreases blood loss by 40%. Danazol, it is not used routinely because of the androgenic side effects. The voice change, which is due to this drug, is totally irreversible. So danazol is not routinely used. Progestins, it can be used either cyclical. Every month, the progestins can be given from day 15 to day 25 so that it regularizes the cycle. And mainly it is used only in anovulatory cycles where there is deficiency of progesterone. It is not much useful in regular cycles with HMB. Ovulatory heavy menstrual bleeding is not useful. In those cases, OCP will be used, and it has an additional effect of contraception also. So this is the most commonly preferred drug, preferred device. Levonorgestrel intrauterine system. So what it is, an intrauterine system which can be kept inside the uterus. So it can be there for almost 5 years. So what it causes, it releases the progesterone. It contains progesterone of about 52 milligram and releases 20 microgram per day. So it slowly releases the progesterone and it locally acts on the uterine endometrium and it causes thinning. So it is useful in women who has this progesterone deficiency. Definitely it is useful, and even in women having adenomyosis, even fibroid where the cavity is not distorted, this can be given. But the main thing is we need to rule out endometrial cancer or hyperplasia, because this is going to be there for a long time, almost 5 years. So it's always better to rule out endometrial lesions like malignancy or hyperplasia, and then once it is kept inside, it can stay there for almost 5 years. It is an OPD procedure. It can be done under ultrasound guidance also, but the main drawbacks are the women will be having spotting on and off in between the cycles also. And the women can become amenorrheic. Almost 60 to 80% will become amenorrheic by 1 year. Weight gain, though it is very rare. So these are the key recommendations for treatment of AUB POM. So whenever there is a polyp which is diagnosed by ultrasound, if there is a single polyp, then we can do polypectomy. Suppose if it is outside the cervix, then we can just do polypectomy by twisting and then removing. Suppose if it is inside the uterus, then hysteroscopic polypectomy can be done. Multiple polyps, it can be removed by hysteroscopy and then followed by, we can keep the LNG IUS so that it suppresses the endometrium and it prevents the recurrence of multiple polyps. AUB adenomyosis. Suppose if the woman wants to conserve uterus for future fertility, then LNG IUS can be given or any other progesterone can be given for a short period of time. Suppose if she's not desirous of, then LNG IUS can be kept also because 5 years it stays there. Otherwise, the next resort will be hysterectomy. Then leiomyoma. There is a classification which I will show you in the future slides. So if the grade 0 and grade 1 fibroids, these can be removed by hysteroscopic myomectomy. Whereas intramural, only if the size is more than 5 cm and the woman wants to conserve the uterus for fertility, she can go for myomectomy. Otherwise, last resort, like multiple fibroids or if the fibroid is very big and if she has completed the family, the option will be hysterectomy. Suppose if she is nearing menopause, asymptomatic, very small fibroids, then we can leave her alone. Then AUBM, the latest classification is atypical hyperplasia and then hyperplasia without atypia, with atypia, without atypia. This is the latest classification of endometrial hyperplasia. So without atypia, LNGIUS is the first line treatment. With atypia, suppose if she has completed the family, hysterectomy is the treatment of choice. Suppose if she has not completed the family, then progesterone can be given, high dose progesterone. But every 3 months, the endometrial biopsy should be repeated. And only if the biopsy is negative for two samples, at least should be negative so that she can plan for pregnancy. If the sample is not negative and if from atypical hyperplasia it has progressed to endometrial cancer, then hysterectomy is advisable. So this is the recommendations for treatment of COIN. Whatever it is, all these are mainly functional. So LNG IUS is the first thing. LNG IUS and progesterone, tranexamic acid as a temporary 4 to 5 days can be given. And last thing will be hysterectomy. So this is the picture showing. See, this is saline infusion sonography where the saline is infused and then the polyp is seen. This is the polyp and this is a multiple polyp. And this is an hysteroscopy picture. This is a uterine cavity and this is the polyp. And this is the latest classification. So without atypia, the risk of getting malignancy is less than 1%. Whereas with atypia, the risk of getting malignancy is about 25 to 33%. That's why if she has completed the family, the management will be hysterectomy. If she has not, then for without atypia, it's okay because it is very less. So LNG IUS can be given for her. So this is the leiomyoma classification, which I have told. So 0, 1, 2, these three come under submucosal. So it is entirely within the cavity. This one less than, more than 50% within the cavity. And in intramural, it is less than 50%. So these two can be removed through hysteroscopy. Hysteroscopic myomectomy can be done for these two. Whereas two, it is more than 50% of the intramural. And three, contacts endometrium, but entirely within the intramural. Four is entirely intramural. It doesn't contact endometrium or serosa. Whereas five, it is more subserosal, but more than 50% will be intramural. Here, subserosal, less than 50% will be intramural. Seven is almost everything is subserosal outside pedunculated. And last will be once it takes circulation from omentum or nearby organs, it becomes parasitic fibroid. So this is a scan picture showing an adenomyosis and fibroid. So this is the endometrial thickness, and this is an anterior wall, this is the posterior wall. So the sunray appearance, and the posterior wall is thicker from endometrium to the posterior serosa. It is thicker than compared to the anterior wall. So this is the characteristic feature of adenomyosis, the sunray appearance, and the surface. It will be very thick. And this is a picture showing a fibroid. This is a fibroid, and this is an endometrial cavity. This fibroid is present in the fundus. So these are all few endometrial ablation techniques: NovaSure, thermal balloon, and hydrothermal balloon ablation. So last resort, if the women is having a lot of anemia, completed the family, she's suffering from everything, then hysterectomy can be done. And hysterectomy is like laparoscopy, vaginal hysterectomy, or abdominal hysterectomy, depending upon the size of the uterus and the diagnosis. Whatever the hysterectomy, the ovaries always, it's better to conserve because the ovaries is very, very important to provide the hormone so that she will not have menopausal symptoms. But the tubes will be removed because the latest theory is the ovarian cancer arises from the tubular epithelial cells. So the uterus and tubes can be removed in hysterectomy, but the ovaries is better to conserve. So thank you. It's better to always manage conservatively by progesterone and LNG IUS before considering a surgical procedure. Thank you.
It's time now to answer your queries. Post them below in the comment section to be answered by our experienced resource personnel on the coming live session next Sunday. Meanwhile, do not forget to subscribe, like, share, and hit the bell icon of the YouTube channel of Salubrity Doctor to be notified if anything informative has been posted. And do share it to all those who would benefit from this. So let's heave care.